Croeso, welcome to our Palm Sunday service. We're very happy to have the Reverend Pastor Arden Strasser preaching for us today. And as many of you know, part of the service today is a memorial to one of our long-term members, Betty Ann Warren. All the music today was chosen by Mary Morgan and Catherine Brace as music that Betty really liked. And there will be, people will be speaking later, but I just wanted to say briefly that a while ago I asked Betty if she would join the church council. And she said that she felt that she wasn't qualified to be on the church council. And I said to her that I couldn't think of anyone who was more qualified to be on our council, that she knew our community, she was wise, she really cared about us all. So that humility that she had personified her. That was who she was. So now our service is going to begin.
Galwadieddoli. Psalm 118, adnodau 1 i 2 ac 14 i 24. Diolchwch i'r arglwydd, oherwydd da yw, ac mae ei ffyddlondeb yn para byth. Dywedid Israel yn awr, y mae ei ffyddlondeb yn para byth. Yr arglwydd i fy nerth am cân, a daeth yn waredigaeth i mi. Clywch gân waredigaeth ymhebyll yr rhai cyfiawn. Y mae dyheulawr arglwydd yn gweithredu'n rymus. Y mae dyheulawr arglwydd yn ei chod wedi ei chodi. Y mae dyheulawr arglwydd yn gweithredu'n rymus. Nid marw ond byw fyddaf, ac adroddaf am weithredoedd yr arglwydd. Disgyblodd yr arglwydd fi'n llym, ond ni roddodd fi yn nwylo marwolaeth. Agorwch byrth cyfiawnder i mi, dofynna i mewn a diolch i'r arglwydd. Dyma borth yr arglwydd, y cyfiawn a ddaw i mewn drwyddo. Diolchaf i ti am fy ngwrando a dod yn waredigaeth i mi. Y main a wrthododd yr adeiladwyr a ddaeth yn brif gofn goglon. Gwaith yr arglwydd yw hyn ac mae'n rhyfeddod yn ein golwg. Dyma'r dydd y gweithredodd yr arglwydd, gorfoleddwn a llawen hawn ynddo.
Thank you. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Join me in a time of prayer. Almighty God, today we remember Betty Ann Walrond. May those who die in the Lord still live with you in joy and blessedness, O Lord. We give you heartfelt thanks for the grace you have bestowed upon your servant, Betty Ann, who has finished her course in faith and now rests from her labors. May we, with all who have died in the true faith, have perfect fulfillment and joy in your eternal glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray, O Lord, today for our world. We stand before you as a people of hope, trusting in your care and protection as you have done in our lives. Shine your peace into our darkness. Merciful God, hear our prayer. For Christians around the world, O Lord, we pray today, beginning the journey this week with Jesus to the cross, unto Easter, reveal to us once again the earth-shaking power of humble service, of unmerited forgiveness, and devotion to you. Your suffering love for all people. Lead us this week from death to life. O merciful God, receive our prayer. Lord God, your Son entered into Jerusalem as the true ruler, poised to lay down his life for his people. Grant that same mind to those in authority over us, that they would discharge their duty even to the last, to the least among us, and so receive your commendation. God, our healer, bring physical healing to those who are ill this week and be with their loved ones. Tend to all people who cry out for relief, those who are isolated, that you stay beside them. We lift up in silence or on our lips the names of those people who we care about in our congregation and in our families and among our friends. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We bring all the prayers of our congregation together, O Lord, in this holy week as we pray the prayer that you taught us to say, Ein Tod, Yerwim. Amen.
Darlleniad o Llyfr yr Actau, penod 10, adnodau 34 i 43. Araith Pedr yn hi Cornelius. A dechreuodd Pedr lefaru. Ar fy ngwir, meddai, rwy'n deall nad yw Dyw yn dangos ffafriaeth, ond bod y sawl ym mhob cenedl sy'n ein ofni ac yn gweithredu cyfiawnder yn dderbyniol ganddo ef. Y gair hwn a anfonodd i feibion Israel gan gyhoeddi efengil tangnefedd drwy Iesu Grist, hwn yw arglwydd pawb. Gwyddoch wir peth a fi drwy holl Judea, gan ddechrau yng Galilea, wedi'r bedydd a gyhoeddodd Ioan, Iesu o Nazareth, y modd yr yneiniodd Dyw ef ar ysbryd glân ac anerth. Aeth ef oedd i amgylch gan wneud daioni, ac iachau pawb oedd dan ormes y diafol, am fod Dyw gydag ef. Ac yr ydym ni'n dystion o'r holl bethau am naeth yng ngwlad yr Iddewon ac yn Jerusalem. A lladasa Dyw gan ei grogi o groesbren. Ond cyfododd Dyw ef ar y trydydd dydd, a pherydd o ddod yn weledig, nid i'r holl bobl, ond i dystion oedd wedi ei rhagethol gan Dyw. Sef i ni, y rhai a fi'n cydfwyta ac yn cydyfed gydag ef, wedi iddo atgyfodi o ddiwrth y meirw. Gorchmynodd i ni brygethu i'r bobl, a thystiolaethau mae hwn yw'r un a benodwyd gan Dyw, yn farnwr y byw a'r meirw. I hwn y mae'r holl proffwydi'n tystio, y bydd pawb sy'n credu ynddo ef, yn derbyn maddeiant pechodau trwy ei enw. Bendithio Dyw y darlleniad yma o'i air sanctaidd.
Good afternoon. My name is Arden Strasser. I'm delighted to be with you in worship today. A special service. It's Palm Sunday. It's the beginning of Holy Week. It's also a time to remember Betty Ann Walrond. I saw the photos and I read the biography of Betty, and it's very touching to remember someone you love. And this sermon, in a way, is very fitting because it's an Easter sermon, and that is the heart of Christianity. So maybe this sermon is just right for Betty, someone who dies in the faith. Let's pray for a moment. Living God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The reading from Acts, if you don't know Welsh, is from the book of Acts. I feel like I know some of you. Some of you know Shruti. I'm Shruti's pastor. I'm from St. Luke's Lutheran Church at Times Square. And Shruti tells me all the time about how much she loves being part of this congregation. So it's a pleasure to meet you through her. The book of Acts is snippets of the earliest church. And this is what was read to you was some of the early consolidation of the early Christian churches, how they put together the story of Jesus and their mission, their identity, their purpose. And Peter tells the story of what happened to Jesus, and then he shifts into they've been witnesses and what it is their task now to do. It's a transition. You remember what happened to Jesus, and now this is what we are called to do. It's a great text, it pulls together the story of Christianity and the mission of the church. Most Christians, or many people, I should say, when they think of the story of Jesus, if they haven't been raised in church or haven't been in a long, long time, or the general culture believes that the story of Jesus is a man who did basically very good things, he got into trouble, and eventually was crucified, and that was bad. But then there's a happy ending, because he's resurrected, he rises from the dead, and all is well. It becomes simplified and narrowed and packaged. But that is not how his followers understood it at the time. That's not really an ending, what a story like that is. The resurrection is not only about what happened on Easter morning. It's about a story that is not a straight story. We like books that have a neat and tidy ending, but the four Gospels do not give a neat and tidy ending. They all end with expectation. They all end with not wanting to finish, but there it is. It's not a classical story. Even Easter, the women come to the tomb to anoint the corpse of someone they loved. As they made their way to the tomb, they're normal. They're thinking about their loss and the person they love, how Jesus changed their lives on that first Easter. All the stories you've learned in your congregations over your life, Jesus healing, Jesus teaching, Jesus forgiving, the parables of Jesus, the Beatitudes, the Sermon on the Mount, his interactions with people, the baptizing, the confrontation with those Pharisees, those know-it-alls, the meals, the discussions, the casting out of bad spirits, Jesus interacting with Gentiles, non-Jews, how that went, and the statements, I am the bread, I am the gate, I am the vine, I am new life, I am living water. All those stories you remember back in the recesses of your mind. Washing the disciples' feet, the loaves and the fishes. The man let down through the roof and Jesus healed him because he could not get in because of the crowd. Remember the woman who was about to be stoned and what Jesus did in her midst. The boat rides, the long walks, Palm Sunday. Today, the story is told how Jesus entered Jerusalem amidst great fanfare. And quickly, the story becomes tense. Intrigue, tension, scheming and plotting, betrayal this week with Judas and the arrest and the scattering of the disciples. And then arrest and torture and abandonment and suffering and death. This is the week of Christians, and this is why it's fitting to preach like this to remember Betty. When Jesus was bound, he was taunted, and remember they pressed that ring of thorns in his head. A sad ending to a great life, worthy of biographies for sure. And that's what spectators do. We love a good biography because it's inspiring. But when the women went to the tomb, the angel said, he's not here. He's not here. He has been raised. And of course, the women are thrown by this on Easter morning. They don't know what to say. They're dumbstruck. They flee from the tomb in amazement and terror. And this is what is central about the resurrection. And for those of us who have been Christians a long time, new Christians get this urgency better because those of us in the church a long time have heard it over and over again. We expect stories to have resolution and finality. We like novels that do that. Life has a beginning and an end. We know how to fit the story of anyone's life into a beginning and an end. It has an arc. Any good writer knows. But we don't know how to tell the story when the end isn't really an end. Imagine with your friends, you tell a story, but it doesn't really have a clean ending. There's not an obvious storyline opening up. We don't have the recipe for dealing with that. We're like the three women who visit the tomb on Easter. We don't know, we can't even talk. The man at the tomb said, "This is not where you're going to find Jesus." And we know something's up. The angel said, "He's gone. He's gone back to Galilee." What does that mean? That means they got to go back to the beginning. They've got to go back to the small, humble place where it all began, Galilee, the North Country, far from the big city, the unimportant place where it all started. They need to take time to ponder and rethink and reconsider. Well, it's not so simple to go home. You know, when you try to go home, homes change. Many of you have moved in your life. You grow up and you go back home, but it's changed and you've changed. It's not so easy to go home. So the story doesn't end. The real story doesn't end. It opens up a new beginning. We threw our worst at Jesus. Absolutely our worst. And Jesus responds with love. Even dying on a cross, he responds with love. No defense, no retaliation, no anger. Was it nonsense for God to be present through a person's life in Jesus? Was it nonsense for God to suffer? Was it nonsense that many chose to follow Jesus in his life? The difficulty with Christianity is trying to ponder dying on a cross. The cross is not about God feeling better about us, but us feeling differently about God. I'll say it again. The cross is not about God feeling better about us, but about us feeling differently about God, learning to be open to God's love that will not let go. God says, in a way, with the cross, "This is how I am most deeply known, on a cross, in vulnerability, in weakness." When you see Jesus forgiving in the stories, that's what God is like. When you see Jesus healing people, that's what God is like. When you see Jesus restoring what is broken, that's what God is like. When you see Jesus identifying with the poor, that's what God is like. When you see Jesus resisting hypocrisy in the Pharisees, that's what God is like. When you see Jesus carrying the cross, that's what God is like. What can that mean for you and me to know that's what God is really like? This is what we step into at Easter. Jesus is risen. The story is not ending. Perhaps it's only beginning. At Easter, Jesus is risen and available and on the move. The ending is now open for new possibilities, not yet imagined. There isn't an obvious way forward. The Easter story is really ours. Ours. It's an invitation of sorts to you and to me to step into a new way of thinking. You are the story. We are the story. The Gospels do not have a clean ending. They open into something new being born, the risen life that is not meant to end. I call it my baptized life, my forever life, my eternal life, and it is now, available simply through faith. Walter Brueggemann, the Old Testament scholar, has a poem for Easter called "But Not Held." It goes like this. We watch this Jesus set deep in the grip of death, but not held. Held overnight, but not held. Held two nights, but not held. Because the power of death could not hold him. We know ourselves to be held. Overnight, for two nights, too long, we are held by fear or anxiety. We're held by grudges and resentments. We're held by doubt and apathy. We're held by too much possessions and stuff. We're held by all manner of the forces of death. We're held and we're powerless. But turned toward you, you, Jesus, in your risenness, make Sundays even for us. Sundays even among us. Even here, even now, we are no longer held. Finally, what is the Easter life like? Well, it's what the church has always done when it's at its best. Although many like to pick at the church, when the church is at its best, people know. Feeding the hungry, quenching people's thirst, deep thirst, welcoming strangers and refugees, clothing the naked, caring for the sick, visiting those in prison, resisting injustice, and the many acts of charity and mercy and advocacy that come out of faith, and all the acts the church is known for throughout history when it is at its best. We are called Easter people. Despite the last difficult years of COVID, we have not lost our hope. We draw strength from one another in every congregation, including the strength that you've drawn from your love with Betty, as we walk the road of faith. At the end of each gospel, the story really begins with us. Amen.
I don't really have any announcements except to say that our next service will be on May the 8th. And I just wanted to welcome you to join us. We have what's called a Te Bach after the service, where we talk and share our memories of Betty. But I think our Te Bach is more of a Te Maur today, because some of us have been very busy cooking Welsh cakes. And something of a bit of a competition as to whose Welsh cakes are the best. Anyway, please join us after for our Te Bach. And would the people who are going to collect the offering please come forward?
Thank you. Well, Anwyl Frodyrach Fiorydd. My dear brothers and sisters, we are gathered now to celebrate the life of Betty Ann Warland. This is a memorial part of the service. Not quite sure what having a memorial service really means. Are we supposed to recount all the wonderful things that we know about Betty? Maybe. But somebody did me an enormous favor and printed up a bio that I think gives everybody a picture of the person we are here to remember. So I'm not going to do any biographical outlines. I am going to say two things only. And the first is what we've tried to do is assemble friends who knew and cared for this wonderful woman and have them fill in some of the color, some of the form, some of the texture of a life that touched ours in many ways. And in so doing, we will gather an image, a feeling of a life with which we shared time and space, and it lifted us and continues to lift us. Betty may not be here, but she's not far off. I'd like to read just a few verses from the Epistle of Paul to the Philippians, not one of the big readings of the church, but it's about the time when Paul was in touch with people trying to work out how to live day by day, week by week. And I think when we lose an important connection, it's important to return to that primary message. And it is, it's from the third chapter of the Epistle to the Philippians. And it's humbling to note that, beloved, I do not consider that I have made it on my own. But this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards that goal for the prize of the call of God in Jesus Christ. Let those of us then who are mature be of the same mind. But if you think differently about anything, this too God reveals. Only let us hold fast to what we have attained. I will be calling people up, because that way it's easy for me to take charge and sit back and listen to everybody's contributions to this memorial. At the end of this service, I hope we will have either written texts or verbal stimulus to remind us about the life of a person who was exemplary in so many ways. A good, modest, kind, generous, giving, sharing person. She was a lawyer. Okay. Maybe that's not the best example of her personality and caring. But she was a teacher. Not just a teacher of special kids. She taught everybody about how to behave, how to conduct themselves, what was right, what was good, not in a pompous and teaching way, but in a quiet, calm, explanatory kind of a way. Betty was a teacher. That's not just a profession. That's a calling. She was a teacher. She teaches us still through the memories we have of the things she said and did. So at this point, I'd like to call up Garth Powers Morgan to talk about his time, his experiences with Betty Ann Warland.
Hi. My name is Garth Morgan, and Betty Ann Walrond was my BOPA. Not by blood, nor marriage, but rather by her deeds, her kindness, and love. She played a most important role in my life. Well, to be honest, she played many roles. Each role different, each role integral to my growth and development, and each role etched in my memory forever. I remember very clearly BOPA Betty on Grandparents' Day, 1992, at Madison Avenue Presbyterian Preschool, which was a surprisingly stressful day for me. At that time, my surviving grandparents lived in Worcestershire and Tamarack, Florida, respectively. So, and I, being a most precocious and inquisitive three-year-old, knew even then that neither of my grandmothers would probably be able to make up the trip to New York City. And I remember being jealous at the start of that day as I watched my friends eagerly showing off their collages and macaroni art to their families. And I knew that one of the teachers would eventually have to come and sit alongside me so I wouldn't be alone. But my parents had a trick up their sleeves, and that was Betty. That day, she was my grand BOPA, sitting alongside my classmates, elderly playmates, smiling proudly as I showed her my drawings. She took time off of work just to make sure I had someone there to see me. She played that part very well. Betty was my teacher. I can't count the number of times she took me on private field trips to the Hall of Science in Queens, or the Natural History Museum where she volunteered, where we roamed well past closing time, exploring new exhibits at the Hayden Planetarium, or watched films and laser shows in the IMAX theater. But I can count, however, the number of posters with Neil deGrasse Tyson's autograph she snagged for me. Two. I left the first one in a taxi cab. But I was very relieved when she presented me with a replacement. I still have it to this day, and it has the inscription, "Garth, keep reaching for the stars and hold on to this one." She was also my sports coach. She helped foster a love for baseball at an early age that I still have to this day. She once rented a car and drove us all up to the Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York, in the middle of a heavy and loud thunderstorm, just so that I could run the bases at Doubleday Field and see the spot where my favorite sport was invented. She waited in long lines so that I could play catch with an old-time pro who boasted that he once struck out Mickey Mantle in a spring training game in 1957. As I grew up, she introduced me to the Beatles and helped me with my math homework. She always made time for me. And even when she took a demanding job teaching science to developmentally challenged students in the Bronx, I could always count on her to explain how the Doppler effect works, to remind me that it was International Peace Day, teach me the importance of being patient. I am who I am today, thanks to her. Thanks to my BOPA Betty.
And now, would Lorraine and Mary Please come forward. Loran Jones and Mary Ann Gwynn.
If roles were reversed and Betty was standing here today delivering a tribute to one of her many, many friends in our Welsh community, it would undoubtedly be thoroughly researched, impeccably edited, and eloquently delivered. Betty's attention to detail, possibly due to her legal training, who knows, was second to none. So I'm apologizing for my meager effort to try and explain the wonderfully long, over 40-year friendship with Betty. They were very happy memories, and going over them in the last few days reminded me that I couldn't remember how or where I met Betty. She seemed to appear and in here in our community. But one of the first recollections I have is the fifth floor kitchen. And the ladies of the congregation were preparing the Gwyl Dewi dinner. And Betty was there, and she seemed very uncomfortable. This wasn't an atmosphere that she was used to. And she was given tasks, and it took her a long time because she wanted to perform every piece of chopping, cutting with perfection. And that's not how you throw together a dinner for 100 people. But eventually, she just fitted into the role. She was at the church tabax helping out, and she was then promoted to be the decorator of the dinner hall whenever we had a Nosenlauen or a Gwyl Dewi dinner. And of course, being Betty, she excelled at that as well. And soon after that, she joined some of the other ladies, all of us, who used to travel to the Labor Day weekend, National Gamanvagani it was called then. And Betty would do the driving because she got horribly car sick if she sat in a car, but she was fine if she drove. So she was our designated driver, and off we would go around the country to these festivals. And she loved to travel with the Welsh, and unexpectedly one summer she showed up in Wales. She wanted to see and meet the people that she'd heard about through our little community here. She had a wonderful time. My friends just took to Betty so well, and whenever they visited me in New Jersey, Betty would be their in-tourist guide to Manhattan. And they were intrigued because of her knowledge and her kindness, especially with their children. And she was held in high esteem among them. Deborah Davis, who also used to be a member of this congregation, Betty and I would often travel together, and Deborah would be given little gigs, usually around St. Patrick's Day. Deborah played guitar and sang Irish and Welsh folk songs. And at one day she was called to a little pub restaurant in Midtown called Olani's to see if she would come and sing there. So she went, and Betty and I followed suit, and soon we became part of the Olani family. We followed them through three different locations in the Times Square area, and Betty also often performed, and particularly their wonderful when Deb was performing the beautiful Celtic New Year celebrations, which went on, of course, till the early hours of the morning. Well, Deb eventually left us and was getting married in North Carolina, so Betty and I thought we'd take a road trip down to the wedding, and it was a lot of fun. But the further south we traveled, the more of the southern Betty I discovered. At each pit stop, her accent became stronger and stronger, and when we got to the wedding, people said, and you are? I'm Betty Ann. Excuse my accent. But she loved the South. And saying that, in the early 2000s, Betty took Mike and I for a tour of the Museum of Natural History, and afterwards we went to dinner. And during the conversation, I happened to mention that Mike was well-read on the Civil War, and, started up a conversation with Betty, at which point, and I kid you not, she was across the table from me, she looked up and she said, "Oh, you mean the War of Northern Aggression?" So I couldn't believe that my liberal, feminist, New York friend was a real Southerner. But I was particularly grateful for Betty's leadership in finding candidates for the St. David's banquets for the Hopkins Medal. She cultivated Stephen Evans, Sylvia Ann Hewlett, and many, many others. She really did a wonderful job with the work of the St. David's and presenting these honorees at the banquets. You'll be seeing those pictures, I think, on the screen later, where she was prominent in introducing our medalists. Our meetings became less frequent as Betty's mobility struggles increased, keeping her homebound at weekends in order to recoup and then regroup for the coming school week. But even though her social life lessened, she maintained regular contact through messages, emails, phone calls, always interested in first what was going on in our families and the children, and then the Welsh events, and of course the political arena. She never ceased to be to interact and inform. During the pandemic, Betty would text greetings for every possible occasion, not just the major holidays. There was Earth Day, there was Pi Day, World Animal Day, International Peace Day, the solstice. All these special days pass now, and I don't wake to Betty's incoming text. I truly, truly miss my dear friend and her beautiful, perfect smile. Betty, know that those of us here today love you and miss you terribly. You've left a legacy that will continue through your students that you nurtured and taught, and really through our children and our grandchildren, whom you touched through your generosity of time and gifts to help instruct, educate, and inspire. Thank you, Betty.
I've been coming here since the beginning of chapel, and I was trying to remember when we first met Betty, and I could not for the life of me remember. I just can't recall a time that Betty has not been a part of this community. But she was just more than a fellow churchgoer. She was a friend. We would spend many times planning St. David's banquets, or, as my mother said, road trips to the different Welsh events throughout the country. And then as we got older, I got married, and I wanted to thank Betty for her generosity. Betty inspired a love of science amongst my girls. And it's unfortunate that Betty didn't have a chance to meet them. As many of you know, we brought our girls home when they were 5 years old, and I was a new mom, so coming to chapel every month wasn't always a possibility. And then, of course, Betty would become more infirm and not be able to make it to chapel. And she still became an integral part of our family. She never missed an opportunity to send gifts that were always science inspired. And they even continue to come now through the mail. And my girls are so excited that, you know, more science is coming. And it's very difficult for me to even think that she's not here. Her presence is felt, and she will be deeply missed. So, thank you.
Thank you. I see Kathleen Herrera, Betty's colleague and friend, is going to come and tell us a little bit more about Betty as a person and Betty as a colleague and friend.
This is the second time I've been in the Welsh Church. The first time was with Betty. Betty and I had met in the dining room at the residence in Manhattan, where we had both lived about 18 years ago. That was when I had first heard about the Welsh community and her singing in the choir, so we had that in common. And my ancestors on my mother's side came from Wales in the 1600s. Each time I met Betty in the dining room, I learned more about her and what a Renaissance woman she was. The next time we talked, it was about her volunteering at the American Museum of Natural History, one of my favorite places in the world. I learned Betty was really in the know, since she was the director of the planetarium, Neil deGrasse Tyson's assistant. I was in awe of Betty's knowledge about science and math. I'm sure many of you today were the recipients of the museum vouchers, which Betty generously obtained for us. She loved sharing her love of the museum with everyone, especially kids. And there was the literary side of Betty, when we would go to Shakespeare in the Park together. I remember, in particular, the time we saw The Merchant of Venice. I was so exhausted from getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning to stand in line for the tickets that I found myself nodding to sleep, even though I was watching Al Pacino as Shylock. Betty was able to fill me in on what I had missed. Another time, when we went to see the musical Fella on Broadway, at one point I glanced over at Betty, and sure enough, she was dozing. So, guess who filled me in on what I had missed? We looked after one another. She had had a full day at school teaching her kids, so I guess she was pulling a double shift, going to the theater that night with me. Talk about an enthusiastic teacher. Betty was always very creative, and one evening at the dining room table, she got out this goop named Ooblig or something like that, that was very gooey, and I'm still not sure what was in it, sort of like a mixture of Play-Doh, water, and glue. Anyway, she had us four friends with this googie stuff, and it was supposed to demonstrate some kind of scientific theory or law, but all I can remember is we were playing with this googie stuff at the dining room table, and I was trying my best not to get it all over me. Betty had us 50-year-old woman letting our inner five-year-old. Betty was certainly my go-to friend. No matter what the problem was, I could count on Betty to solve it. One time, I had bought this chest of drawers for my room, not realizing that I would have to assemble it. Yikes. I am one of the world's worst do-it-yourselfers. But Betty to the rescue. We spent the whole night, the whole day, right before the 4th of July, assembling that thing. The instructions were all in Chinese, which of course we're both fluent in, and the diagrams were, in my mind, completely indecipherable. But with Betty's know-how and ingenuity, we were able to assemble it, with a lot of laughter too. Honestly, in a million years, I would not have been able to make heads or tails of those instructions without Betty. Betty was a very generous person with her time, but also with her gifts. Some, I must say, a bit quirky, but that was Betty's unique way of seeing the world. She wanted her friends to be prepared for all that came our way. For example, whatever New Yorker needs, Betty provided. Every New Yorker needs to get stress away from their head, and so Betty satisfied our mental needs by giving us these. Then, on the physical side, if New York ever had a blackout, no batteries, no electricity, Betty provided us with I never saw one of these before, but it's a flashlight and you crank it. So none of her friends would be in the dark. And then, all those in Betty's sphere must have a space pen. And this is a space pen that writes in any direction, upside down, right side up. And this is when, if we ever go into space, we will have the perfect pen and we will be able to write in space. So that's how Betty thought. Lastly, there was this rock that she gave some of her friends. And mine says, think. And it exemplifies Betty as a thinking person and a very thoughtful person to all her friends, family, and those who encountered her. Let's see. She often texted her friends and family, highlighting days that you might not have been aware of, as people have already made reference to. Two of the last texts I received were Happy Children's Day and Happy Celtic New Year's Eve, which doesn't surprise me that Betty would have found those days especially meaningful to her and wanted to share them with her friends and family. There were two of her friends that lived in the same residence, and they were not able to be here today, so they wanted me to read their tributes to Betty. The first one is from her friend, Helen Bachthaler, who was in Florida this weekend. Betty was a caring friend who gave us thoughtful gifts like an American Museum of Natural History tote bag, which I use every day, interesting necklaces, a credit card holder, to name a few. She always kept us informed. Days of like summer solstice, climate week, International Peace Day, autumn equinox, World Animal Day, World Space Week, World Children's Day. She was a dedicated teacher who really invested in the children with whom she was entrusted. Betty had a bright and inquiring mind and a good heart. I enjoyed our dinners together at the Webster Apartments, as well as the times that we went out to dinner with other Webster friends after our move from there. She will be truly missed. And then another friend who now lives in North Carolina, who met Betty in New York. I often browse the greeting card section of a store, hoping to find a card with a beautiful floral design, accompanied by a verse that expresses all the warm feelings I'm holding in my heart for a friend. One day, I found such a card. and the adjectives used in the verse describing the attributes of a friend were patient, kind, caring, generous, an empathetic listener, yet an active supporter. I bought the card, signed it, "Thank you for your friendship," and sent it to my friend Betty. I first met Betty while we were both residing at a woman's residence on the west side of Manhattan. About 200 women lived there in a room and board situation. One night in the dining room, I spotted her sitting alone with her food tray and a book. Of course, I had to sit down and get acquainted, later inviting her to share dinner the next time with me and at a table full of my eclectic friends. She accepted the invitation and quickly assimilated with the group, some of whom were a world traveler working for the U.S. mission to the UN, an OR nurse, and a leading cancer hospital, two scientists, one from Italy and one from India, who were responsible for matching organ donors, a seasonal salesperson at Macy's department store, two others with office jobs while pursuing their own special interests, singing, writing, and teaching. Our table always remained open, especially for short-term interns from foreign countries. At the time we all met Betty, she was teaching special ed students in the Bronx after having spent some time as a paralegal. We also learned about her many outside interests. She was particularly proud of serving as a docent at the American Museum of Natural History. Betty's favorite time while there was Halloween, when her students slept overnight. She also enjoyed being a member of the Welsh choir. I remember traveling to New Jersey to see and hear the choir perform. I enjoyed so much her telling of her summer school activities, like being able to get in the pool with her kids. And one year she told us she had taken her students to the Jewish Museum. While there in the back of the building, they participated in an archaeological dig. Wow. I remember that at Christmas time, we girls all joined in to give her our grab bag gifts, the same every year. A little keychain with tiny furry animals attached. I also would contribute with a baby animal calendar and or a gift certificate to an arts and crafts store. Early in my relationship with Betty, I had occasion to pass on to her a heavy pink sweater. She loved its color, its fit, and its warmth, and promptly she gifted me with a book by my favorite author. Then one night I mentioned that the VHS tape of my favorite Christmas movie was worn down from overuse. 2 days later, I had a new tape, a gift from you-know-who. And so it went. Each time I would gift Betty and the whole dinner crowd with an event or an outing, like a concert or a horse and buggy ride through Central Park, Betty would reciprocate with all my favorite CDs, DVDs, and books pertaining to certain movie stars, opera singers, etc. I found that no one could outgift Betty. Her quiet strength lent itself to be a trusted confidant and a helpful advisor. She held on to more than one secret of mine and offered reliable advice when I needed it. To sum up the life and work of my friend Betty, an old adage comes to mind: the good that people do lives after them.
And now we will hear a few words from Audrey Roberts, one of the stalwarts of this community and of this congregation, and one of the best Welsh cake bakers around. I do hope she came loaded today with Welsh cakes. Oh, go home. No Welsh cakes.
Only my love for Betty.
That's good.
Hello. I'm Audrey Roberts. Can you hear? All right? Okay. I met Betty here, actually, at Rutgers, upstairs, in the Women's Welsh Club about 35, 40 years ago. Anyway, a long time. I'm 91, so I kind of forget the years. She used to come and visit us occasionally to Croton and Hudson, where she was always willing to pitch in and help. We were always fixing something up in the house. which when we bought it was falling down around her ears. So I remember a day when she was sitting on the floor painting the wainscoting in one of the bedrooms, and that job is still there. I think it must be about 40 years ago that she painted that. You know, the Women's World Club enjoyed the visit that we made to the Natural History Museum. She organized that for us, and that was a Saturday afternoon of the Women's Welsh Club. She was so kind, you know, and so generous with her time. We took a trip to Portugal. She joined with myself and two other colleagues from the school. At the time, she wasn't teaching. I think she was still at the law firm that she was working in. Anyway, of course, she wanted to drive, and there was another colleague whose husband had umpteen cars and was a really keen driver. So every day there was this argument, who was going to drive the car that day? So Betty said, I must drive because I get sick. And the other woman said, but I'm the best driver. So we had an argument during that trip, although Portugal was very beautiful too. As far as her teaching career was concerned, Betty was such a loving, caring person. There's no way that a teacher could be better than she was, because so many teachers we know were full of just the job, you know, getting it done, teaching what they had to teach, but she had something very special to give. And her caring with children was really remarkable. I'm sure that all those children that she touched in her life still remember her. They must, because teachers like that affect your life for the rest of the time that you're alive. They really make such an impression on you, and Betty would be one of those teachers. And having taught myself for 20 years or more, I know what being a good teacher is. Anyway, after I retired, I didn't really see much of Betty except at church when we met. And I always was enthusiastic in telling her she should have a hip replacement, because I had a hip replacement and I didn't need it any much as she more than she did. In fact, less than she did. So, but she never did. I don't think she did. Does anyone know whether she actually had a hip replacement? I don't think so. And she always struggled with it, and I couldn't understand. You know, being a science teacher, she should have known better, you know. I always, you know, nagged her about it, but she wouldn't do it. I don't know why. Anyway, we're all going to miss her terribly. She was generous with her time, with her love. And Betty, I'm sure that you're with the angels up there. You must be. Thank you.
Thank you, Audrey. It's not violating any state secret, but Audrey is an amazing lady who is, let's say more than 90 years old, and vigorous and busy. And I think we're all very grateful that she's here today. And now we have to turn to our good friend Catherine Brace, one of Betty's longtime friends and colleagues. this way.
Came the long way around. Well, Betty Waldron was unique, and that's why I liked her so much. There was only one Betty. I mean, she was just so intelligent, so knowledgeable in many fields, and yet she never made you feel inferior or insignificant. She never boasted about the things that she achieved in her life. And when I was coordinating her obituary, I found out things about her that I had absolutely no idea. For instance, that she graduated in Russian from Duke. I had no idea she could speak Russian. And that she was third in her year graduating from New York Law School. All this was amazing information that she never shared with us because she was just a meek person. She was always smiling, and other people have talked about this, and we'll see her smile on the photos at the end. She also had a great sense of fun and a great sense of humor, and I laughed a lot with Betty when I would meet her. One day she called me up and she said, I've got tickets to go and see a black stand-up comedian from South Africa. Would you like to come? I said, yes. So off I went, and Kathleen, who's with us today, was also there. And we enjoyed every minute, and we laughed, and he was wonderful. And then a little later, she called me up again, and she said, you know, that stand-up comedian, he's back in town. Do you want to go? So I said, yes. So we went again, and that stand-up comedian turned out to be Trevor Noah, who now, of course, is hosting The Daily Show. And I would say to Betty, Betty Waldron, you discovered Trevor Noah. And she would laugh at that. Betty was feisty. She would love a discussion, and she'd talk to anybody. And for a long time, I was a member of the British Academy of Television, of Film and Television Awards, BAFTA, in New York. And as a member of BAFTA, I could take one guest to any of the screenings during the year. And we had a lot of the top films that they would screen. And Betty, I would invite Betty quite often to these screenings because Betty loved the film. Didn't matter if it was a sleazy rom-com or a subtitled documentary. She loved a good film. And so we would sit down in the theater, and if anybody started to whisper or rustle a candy paper, Betty would shout straight away, turn around and say, would you please be quiet? Some of us are trying to enjoy this movie. She was never afraid of speaking her mind. And then in these screenings, at the end, we usually have a Q&A, and the director would be there, the producer, and the main stars. And the moderator would then ask if anybody in the audience would like to ask a question. And very often, Betty would put her hand up, and then she would ask a very good question, very thoughtful. And there was many a time when then she got into a one-on-one discussion with the likes of Wes Anderson or Dame Judi Dench. That was not unusual. And my favorite story about Betty and BAFTA was when we went to see The Things We Lost in the Fire. And after the movie, there was a Q&A with the director, the producer, and the two main stars. And that was Halle Berry and Benicio del Toro. So after the screening and the Q&A, we went back to the foyer, and I said, Betty, I'm just going to the bathroom. I'll be back in 5 minutes. I left her in the foyer. And when I came back, she was in deep discussion with Benicio del Toro. That was Betty. We've heard that she was very kind and extremely generous, and she certainly was with me and my family too. When we returned from Wales after 12 years of being back there, She came to tutor my daughter, Fabienne, who had had her education only through the medium of Welsh when we were in Wales. So she needed to get up to speed, and she was going straight into high school here in New York, so Betty came to tutor her in math. And Betty would arrive from her job, great big haversack on her back, put it down, sit down, have an hour's math lesson, and then I'd cook for the three of us, and that was the beginning of a 22-year-old relationship and friendship with Betty for me and my family. And when my daughter Fabienne had her little girl, Olivia, Betty took to her, although she never met her, and was extremely generous in giving her Christmas gifts, birthday gifts, just because gifts. And so Betty came to know Olivia, even though she didn't meet her, and Olivia's only three, by the way, because all through COVID, I would send Betty little videos of Olivia. This was Olivia on her scooter, Olivia playing doctors, Olivia singing a Welsh song, Olivia wishing you happy birthday. And Betty loved to receive these videos. She told me that she would download them and watch them time and time again. And this was the way we kept in touch all through COVID, because of course we didn't see each other. My daughter Fabienne was running the New York Marathon last November, and I did invite Betty to come and meet the family, but unfortunately she was not well enough to come out. So Olivia never met Betty, but I look after Olivia a lot now, and I've made a little bedroom for her in a playroom in my house. And almost everything in that playroom comes from Betty. So when Olivia and I get out the Hungry Hippos or the Play-Doh or the crayons, the books about space, the planets, the monarch butterfly, the weather, bugs, all of this comes from Betty. And so every time we get something out, we say, do you remember Betty bought this for you? Or Olivia will say, Betty bought this for me. And so Betty lives on, in a way, in our house and in our memories. Betty was a dear friend, and I miss her. Cysgan dawel, Betty Annwyl.
Thank you. We've now reached a point where we can talk some more about the planets, maybe. So we are honored to have with us today Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson, and he has offered to give us some thoughts and memories of his interaction with Betty. If you'd like to step forward.
Hello, everyone. I serve as director of the Hayden Planetarium, which got more than one mention this afternoon. And it is quite the escape from the rest of life in a way that connects you with the cosmos. A couple of points to just fill in. That mysterious goopy substance that you described, it's called oobleck. Yeah. And you make it with a mixture of cornstarch and water. And the reason why it's interesting, which Betty surely knew and fully understood, is, yeah, it looks a little bit like Play-Doh. If you punch it, it cracks. But if you just sort of lean on it, your fist slowly descends into it. So the substance doesn't react the same way to an abrupt force than it does to a soft force. And so it's an exotic substance, and there's hardly anything else you would ever meet that does what this substance does. And so you need somebody like Betty to know that that's something interesting to keep people entertained for endless hours. Hearing others speak of Betty and her life and their interactions with her, you've hardly left anything for me to say, because so much of what I experience resonates deeply with what all of you have said, starting with the fact that I don't even remember when I first met her. She was just always there. And what perhaps contributed to that fact is, though I serve as director, I don't run the volunteer program at the American Museum of Natural History. That's a whole other department. So volunteers are assigned based to various departments based on their expressed interest. So she was just kind of always there. And so I knew very little of the rest of her life. And am I the only one speaking today without an accent of some kind? I'm just from the Bronx, I'm sorry. But what I noticed, unlike anyone else who just comes through and then goes back home, Betty, as a volunteer, she always had questions back for me. She would be hosting, you know, helping to run one of our evening events. We'd have a speaker, some famous speaker, won a Nobel Prize, whatever. And she did due diligence, guiding visitors in and out. And at the end, she said, "Neil, can I talk to you?" I said, "Sure." And here it comes. "Neil, I was wondering about that lecture." And she'd say, and by the way, she'd ask a question that was not some easy question, like how big is the sun or how hot is it? No, it was, if the universe is expanding, then what's it expanding into? I said, "Betty, I don't know, I'm sorry." And she would ask questions, not simply that I wouldn't know, but nobody knows yet. And so that told me she's a deep thinker, going beyond the edges of what is known into the realm of the mysteries that remain with us to this day. And I'd only later learn that she was an educator. But not just any educator, an educator, special education students. You know who those teachers are? They're not just a different kind of educator, they're better educators. Because they have to know and learn what key fits in to unlock the curiosity of very different kinds of students at all times. And to have that ability and retain a level of curiosity that resembles what kids have, that's a special person. I mean, just think about it. We've all seen, if it wasn't one of us among those, who at the last day of school, you run down the steps, we know these people, they throw their books in the air and they say, "School's out." They're celebrating no longer learning. Who is that? That's not Betty. Betty would have never been that person. Betty would have been sad school was out, because no longer are the moments to learn. You'd have to wait for the summer to end. Or when you graduate, what do you then do with your life? Do you become a lifelong learner? Are you curious throughout your life? Every kid is that. Some adults retain it. She's one of those adults. And as an educator myself, I deeply celebrated this level of continuous curiosity manifest within her. And now hearing these testimonies, I know where all those extra comp tickets went that we had such status with all her friends. The drawer would be empty. Okay, Betty's been in and out of the drawer. Okay. I won't take more of your time, just to say that we'll miss her. She was part of a battery of volunteers that served programming at the American Museum of Natural History. And volunteers at the museum, they're like the lubrication between a stodgy administration and a curious public. They just allow information to flow in all the ways it needs to enhance and enrich the experience of visitors. And I'm here with my assistant at the time and two other volunteers. We all knew Betty very well, and we will deeply miss her energy. Someone described her as meek. I wouldn't use the word meek. I would say humble. She was humble, given all that she knew and all the power of knowledge she wielded. It was never held against you. It just lived within her and was an enlightenment that would be shared when the occasion arose. And like I said, she remained a lifelong learner. And another point made earlier, I will emphasize it once again, that as long as Betty remains in our memories and in our spirits, she actually will not have died. She will remain alive within us. Thank you.
Well, words to take to our hearts. And I think the key here is it's one of these wonderful things we've heard so many times. I don't remember when I met her first. Well, the thing is, I don't think you need to remember when you met her first. We all need to remember that she was there when we needed Betty. And you can put that in the past tense if that works for you. For me, she's there. She's just there. In our house, we look around and we see the impact of Betty in our lives. Garth's enormous and heavy baseball encyclopedia, the rack of CDs, which she introduced music to him of every genre. Betty is there, Betty is here. In our hearts, yes, but in this community in a more profound and spiritual way. Maybe that's not quite the language we all share, but I think the message is true. And at this point, I'm going to ask if there is anyone who would like to say something from the heart, please come forward right now and take the mic. Okay. William A. Perry, a longtime friend of this congregation and a member of the council for many years.
Owen, I am a recipient of those complimentary tickets. Betty was very special, and I think we all know that. And it's tough sitting beside Paula Borger, who's tearing up every moment, and you're trying not to tear up. But I can remember when I met Betty. I met Betty when I traveled from New Jersey with Lauren Jones and dear Ann Phillips. Do you remember Ann? So beautiful, such a wonderful woman. And so when I came here, at the end of the service doing Tabach, this lovely lady came over to speak to me. She didn't ask me, what are you doing here? Or who do you know? Or who's Welsh? Or do you speak Welsh? She just said, hi, I'm Betty. How are you? Tell me a little bit about yourself. But it wasn't about yourself as wanting to know anything under the sun, negative. It was about yourself because she cared. And one of the things that I really, truly loved about her was a sense of grace. Betty showed grace and Betty showed love. And you would think within a setting like this that would be normal, but that's not always normal. But she was loving and she was kind and she showed grace. Grace about, or showing the grace of the God that she supposedly served and loved and who she was. And our talks, I felt that she was kind of a maverick in the sense of just being different and doing what's right. And yes, the humility was there. She was greatly humble, but she was kind of a maverick in that sense. You know, and I'll finish with this because we've all heard all the wonderful things about her, which are true. When I received the call from David about her, I was floored or stunned. The last time I spoke to Betty was October. And to hear that, you know, how she passed away, it was difficult. But then I began to think of all the positive things. You know, being up on the fifth floor kitchen and doing different things and being a part of things. And at that time, it was Deborah Davis and Jamie and David and Ron and a few, David Morgan and Paul. It was just a wonderful time. And she helped that with her love and with her grace. And that's really all I have to say about her, because so much has already been said about her, and I don't want to be redundant that much. But grace and love, and that's what made the difference about her. And yeah, I have about 1/10 of Welsh from my dad's side, for those who might want to know. But Betty was so loving and so kind, and I will always, always, always remember her. Thank you.
Okay, I call now on Ms. Mary Morgan one more time to tell us from her perspective what Betty means to us all as a community and as a friend.
Betty had a twinkle. She always had a twinkle in the eye when I remember Betty. She was usually asking me a deep question about singing in Welsh and singing the alto part, and I never quite had the right answer for her. But she always made you think, and think deeply about what you were doing. I also just about remember when I met Betty, it was in the 1990s, when there was such a vibrant community here. David as a president, and all kinds of young people taking part, the Welsh Women's Club and everything, and Betty was deep into it. And I came into that community and had the idea for this North American Welsh choir kind of thing. And it was a great experiment. And Betty jumped into that great experiment with us all. And with us, she learned to sing alto. And in the same way as Lorraine experienced Betty with the chopping, that was Betty with the alto section. So bit by bit, Betty learned to sing alto. And I'm sure this afternoon, if Betty was here, she would be going up to Emily and comparing notes about singing in Welsh for the first time. And what a wonderful job you did, Emily. Thank you very much. And to Cynthia with the hymns and the songs that we thought Betty would enjoy. So this afternoon, we thought we'd close with a montage, really, of pictures of Betty singing with the choir. She had friends all over the country, across the US and in Canada, because the little experiment and the good idea all came to fruition, and we did a lot of traveling together. So just quickly thinking back and some of the things that, some of the places we went together, as Laurent mentioned, the National Gaman Vagani in 1999, the choir did its big debut after all of the little rehearsals and finding our way around everything. There was 110 voices on a stage with 2,500 people, and Betty was in the alto section with Deb Davis next to her. Wherever Deb sang, that's where Betty sang as well. So the two went together in the alto section. So that was in 1999. In 2000, Betty sang with us in Asbury Park and at 4th Presbyterian Church here in New York. And then on the Sunday, we sang here at Eglwys y Cymru with Marsha Williamson at conducting the Gaman Vagani from the organ. And then from there, 2001, Lorani, remember, we went out to Washington State, we went to the Olympic Peninsula, and we sang in some beautiful parts of the country. 2002, we went on tour to Wales and made sure that the cases fit into the buses because we were a packed two-bus tour. And we went all over Wales and had a great time. In 2003, she sang with us at Trinity Wall Street. And we saw each other at the Tribeca Film Center. Again, as Catherine said, she liked a good film, and it was the good film of our tour to Wales the previous year, and all of our experiences that we shared together. The night before, we'd also sang at the Yale Club for the St. David's Society banquet, and we all sang at that event. And the next morning, on the Sunday morning, we sang at the Orthodox Church in Brooklyn for the Belarusian Orthodox Church. In 2004, we sang at the British Memorial Garden here in New York, which is now called the Queen Elizabeth II British Garden. In 2004, it was under construction and a dream in mind to remember the British fallen victims of 9/11. And then in 2005, she came with us to DC to the Smithsonian, where we had the privilege of representing Wales in the Smithsonian Festival to recognize Wales and Ireland. So the pictures you'll see are some of those experiences that we shared together. Looking at through the pictures, you always find Betty on the edge or behind, on the left-hand side because of the alto section, but she is there. And the music you'll hear is a song that's been a favorite of the choir for many, many years. It's called Hafan Gobaith, A Haven of Hope.
Oh,
Is it okay? Before we join together and sing the last hymn in the program, I think it's important to just say thank you to each and every one of them, of our friends and neighbors and associates who have stepped forward to remember a wonderful person and to be grateful for a life well lived, for friendships enjoyed, for good times shared and maybe some tough times eased by a loving and good person. And so, from me to you all, a reading again from the Epistle to the Philippians. Rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Don't worry about anything. In everything you do, with prayer and thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God, so that the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds forever. Shall we now all stand and sing the last hymn, number 66 in our hymnal? Nid yw'n gofyn bywyd moethus, I seek not a world of riches, I only seek a good and clean heart.
Thank you.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we humbly commend your servant Betty Ann Walrund. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. May the God of peace, who brought again the dead from the dead, our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.